One of the first of many tussles I engaged in as a kid was on some kind of camping trip I went on with a group that shuttled punks out of New York and away from bad things happening on weekends. Once we arrived to join the bigger group of campers in the woods, however, the rural and suburban brats we met poked fun at us relentlessly, mocking everything from our lack of outdoor prowess and appropriate gear to the way we spoke. To their disliking, a lot of my friends from Queens were either from other countries, some barely spoke English at all, and the rest of us had thick New York accents. After more than a day of this childish torture, I regrettably got into it with one kid who mocked the neighborhood that I was from. I should have known that it was inadvisable to say I hailed from a place called Flushing, but having a fair amount of love for my borough of Queens, however, the comment spurred me to escalate. Until this past week, that was the last time that I can recall feeling passionate about Queens. I tend to loathe when people take pride in the arbitrary place where they were born. But after watching heads of countless creeds and colors rally against Donald Trump's sickening immigration campaign this past week, I can't help but feel warmly about where I came of age. Every public school class picture was a smorgasbord of kids from different walks of life, nearly all of us close friends from early breakfast to the playground after the last bell. You may have seen where this is going. Our new president, of course, is also from Queens, just a few miles or bus stops away from my old apartment, as it turns out. And while I'm sure that the privileged life that Donald Trump enjoyed in Jamaica Estates was quite different from that which I lived in Flushing, I have no doubt that, like me and everybody else in Queens, Trump lived among a rich variety of individuals, many of whom hailed from countries his administration now looks at with scorn and intolerance. Largely because of where he's from, I do believe that Trump knows he is wrong to marginalize, even demonize certain ethnic and religious groups, not to mention all the women, people with disabilities, and everybody else he has maligned. Unfortunately, the president is addicted to the peer approval points doled out by those who benefit and profit when oppressed people suffer. It's a toxic way to live, let alone lead a nation, but I doubt that he learned such behavior in Queens. For this edition of Beyond Boston, where our goal is to bring you the best news features from PEG access stations throughout Massachusetts, it only made sense to focus on the many local contributions to the growing national outrage. Now sit tight, because we're about to bring you on a protest whirlwind featuring a piece from Cambridge Community Television on the post-inaugural Women's March in Boston, followed by interviews with marchers by Malden Access Television. All simultaneous crises considered, we're sure it won't be our last look at these issues.
Saturday, January 21st, 2017, the day after the inauguration.
The women just keep coming, more and more.
I am here for the people, all the people.
To support our fellow women in making sure that all of our rights are protected.
I'm here today to show my support and to publicize how I feel about women's rights and equality for all.
We're lucky and we're in a country that we can do this in a peaceful way, and we're gonna exercise that right.
Bearing witness is an important piece of civil action.
I feel like the real patriots are here today, that we're here trying to save America. So why are you here today, sir?
Support women's rights.
And what does that matter to you?
Women are important. I believe in what women believe in.
I trust women, and I think we'd be best off to have a matriarchy for the next 500 years. There's no other place in the world I'd rather be than right here with all the people who I voted with, not for Trump, for Hillary Clinton, and just for sanity and humanity and dignity. I can't believe the alternate reality that has dropped upon the United States, and I'm here to resist that and to be with my people and be strengthened.
I am here because I have to be here. I have no choice. My life is political. As an African American woman, as someone who needs health care, and someone who believes in women's rights, black rights, lesbian, gay, transgender, bisexual people's rights, he is going to eradicate all of that, and I will not stand for it. And so I have to speak out, I have to march, I have to protest, I have to do whatever it takes.
Seeing that sea of people over there and that sea of pink hats, I just am amazed and comforted, and I feel more hopeful. I just have to feel more hopeful, but I know it's going to be really hard. I just know it's going to be really, really hard. It's hard to keep up on a daily basis with the lies that are headed our way. There's so many causes, there's so many issues, there's so many different areas of concern. It's really going to be tough.
I'm here to show numbers. We have power in numbers.
We're all in this together.
I think this many voices cannot be ignored. I think there's only a few of them, and there's a hell of a lot of us, and I'm of the opinion that we are legion.
You have to mobilize the people, because the people, I think the mobilization of the people is what is going to make change. Even though we have somebody who's like Teflon, and everything seems to roll off of him, but at some point, we are going to get through. And I am waiting for that moment, okay? And I know it'll happen. We will rise, okay? Everything that Obama did is not for naught. We will rise.
I had to make my voice heard. I had to be part of this movement.
I
didn't know if I was going to do it until yesterday. And the way I felt waking up, there was no way that I could be okay with myself if I didn't join this movement today. And I feel like the more of us that are here, the more likely our voices will be heard. I'm not giving up. So I feel like, you know, this is the way to push forward.
And after this march, what would you say might be a next step? Like, I mean, it's hard to say, but...
That's the question, I guess. Yes. We're all facing that question. If I think of something, though,
I'll more.
Sounds great.
Well, enjoy. Thank you for coming. Thank you for being here.
Absolutely.
So this fight for the woman, right?
Yes.
We're here to stand for the march, for love, peace, and unity. That's all what we need. When we go back to Malden, International Women's Day is coming, and we are going to be working more harder to be all as one in the Malden community.
Marching today for everyone, in terms of diversity and inclusion, I support Planned Parenthood. I support immigration, refugees, as well as access to women's health care and affordable health care. So this march really is for everyone who has something to lose with this incoming inauguration, this incoming administration, I should say.
To be very succinct is, I'm here to help us unite this country, to bring us together instead of divide us.
I'm here for like everyone, especially the people who can't fight back like against this, the people who can't speak up or who won't. I'm here to like show them that it's okay to fight back. If you feel oppressed.
It's a tragedy. I was so saddened the day of the election, and I'm still sad. Yesterday I put on Facebook, I'm wearing black today because I'm mourning, and I truly, you know, in my core, that's how I feel.
I'm here because, you know, this is a very, it's a scary time, and I think it's very energizing and for me, hopeful to be in a group of people like this.
Hi, I'm here to stand with everyone from all walks of life who's scared right now. And there are a lot of people out there who are wondering how their group is going to be treated in the new administration. Malden is one of the most diverse cities in the state, and we're here representing that we embrace diversity in Malden.
I'm here for my daughter and for the next generation of women coming up. I think it's really important, and I'm going to let her explain why we're here.
Well, this is a time of a lot of uncertainty in our country, and I feel like a lot of people here feel that our president right now isn't representative of the majority of America. There's a lot of minorities, especially women. Being here puts pressure on them and shows that we will not be quiet and let them walk all over us. We are Americans, and we deserve the respect that the people up top, the wealthy white males, deserve too.
Thank you so much.
She said.
Hi, I'm Haley Hamilton, staff writer with the Boston Institute for Nonprofit Journalism, and I'm here today with Kanisha Hans, a longtime Planned Parenthood volunteer who also spoke at the Boston Women's March. Hi, Kanisha.
Hi.
How you doing?
Good.
Awesome. Thanks for being here.
Yeah.
So you gave a great speech at the march. You talked a lot about your personal experiences with Planned Parenthood, why you volunteer, why it's important to you. And for the people who didn't get a chance to hear that, can you give us a quick intro?
Yeah, so I became a longtime Planned Parenthood volunteer after actually being a patient there myself when I was a teenager. And I was just so overwhelmed by how nice everyone was who was working there. And it started to occur to me that I needed to contribute something back to Planned Parenthood because they had given me so much. And so I've been a volunteer with them for the past 3 years.
Awesome. Very cool. One thing that really stood out to me at the march was, you know, huge turnout, and one of the key rallying cries was around reproductive rights, keeping abortion legal, having mm-hmm. access to birth control, and a really important point, something that we definitely need to fight for and pay attention to. Mm-hmm. But it's come up that given the call for equality and talks of diversity around the march as well, that some of those could have been kind of alienating, mm-hmm. particularly to trans and queer women. Mm-hmm. How do you feel about that? Where does that fit in for you?
I think that that was definitely a valid concern that I think the organizers thought about as well. So at the Boston Women's March in particular, I think it was great to see a variety of voices. However, I do agree when looking out into the crowd, seeing signs depicting female genitalia, saying the future is female, can be extremely alienating mm-hmm. to trans women in particular. And I think that it's natural to kind of take your own personal experiences and think that that's, you know, the biggest, most important thing that we have to fight for. Mm-hmm. And certainly, you know, reproductive justice is something that's coming under attack already. However, I think that sometimes when we do go to marches or we get involved and we're looking for ways to get involved, it's important to first take a step back and actually listen from some of the most marginalized groups that are out there. And trans people are definitely one of the most at-risk groups that I think that we all need to listen to more often before we actually go and mm-hmm. speak.
Absolutely. Just gonna carry on with that a little bit. I liked what you said about taking a step back and listening, because another criticism of the march was, you know, we're gonna see all you nice white women at the next Black Lives Matter march, right? You're gonna be there. There is a lot of feeling that this is too little too late for mm-hmm. a lot of white women getting involved in mm-hmm. fighting oppression and fighting for equality. So where do we go from here then? If that, you know, because they're not wrong. Where have all you people been? Where were all of us for the last Black Lives Matter rally? And what do we do?
Yeah, I think that I definitely agree. It was, you know, seeing a sea of white women there was kind of, for me personally, I'm involved with an organization called the Boston Doula Project, which is primarily people of color. Mm-hmm. And I thought the same thing. Where have you been when, you know, other people's lives have been at risk and we've been asking for your help? But I think that this march was actually a good opportunity to I think that it's been very easy for white women in particular to kind of just turn a blind eye to a lot of these issues. But to have the march there, I think was really kind of a rallying cry. And I think that it empowered a lot of people to actually take that step back and listen. So I would hope that after the march, it's not like we've marched and that's it. They actually do get involved with local organizations, because I think that if you look in your community, you'll already see lots of people of color organizing around really important issues, and to get involved with that.
Absolutely. So we've talked about taking a step back, and you touched a little bit on what to do going forward. There's been talk of the 100 days, 100 actions. There's Facebook groups all over the place. Go get your postcards. Mm-hmm. Sign up for this rally. Here's what we do. Call your senators. What are the next steps? What are the most concrete things people can think about doing right now?
Yeah, so I think that going to marches and going to rallies is definitely great, but it can't be just that. You really do have to take the time to call your senators or call congresspeople. And if it's not your senators or your congresspeople, like we're sitting here in Brookline, it's a very liberal area, go out and encourage other people to, you know, go on Facebook, and you probably have a lot of friends who live in red districts. Encourage them to get involved. And also, again, like I said before, look within your local community and see how you can support people who have already been doing this work.
Awesome. All right, well, thank you so much for taking the time. We're next up is a clip from Brookline Interactive Group and their coverage of the Boston Women's March.
This is what a feminist looks like.
Show me what a feminist looks like.
This is what a feminist looks like.
Show me what a feminist looks like.
This is what a feminist looks like.
We're here today because of the power of women. The power of women to come up with good ideas like this rally.
Boston was overflowing with people on Saturday as more than 170,000 gathered to attend the Women's March held at the Boston Commons in support of women's rights, and from the looks of it, in resistance to President Trump as well.
I'm here to celebrate the diversity of America and the democracy that guarantees us our right to assemble peacefully and to protest, because that's not available in many places in the world.
Because we felt we needed to take a stand against a whole lot of things that seem like they're going to be turned around to the opposite of what really should be happening, thanks to Trump. So we're here to stand for climate and LGBT rights.
Marchers included Massachusetts Representative Joe Kennedy, who led Planned Parenthood's contingent of marchers and held an intimate rally of his own before marching.
To stand up and to show Donald Trump and his administration what it means when you say we got each other's back.
Out of all the organizations, why did you decide to march with Planned Parenthood today?
Planned Parenthood stands for access to health care. It stands for women's rights. It stands for making sure that we all look out for each other and care for each other. Being here today with so many hundreds of other volunteers standing up and standing for what we believe in, I thought was really important.
One thing I can thank Donald Trump for is for bringing all these people together here, because I've never felt such energy before in my life.
I was very angry when Trump was elected. But I really believe today needs to be about tolerance, and that means for our leader as well.
Now, we can whimper, we can whine, or we can fight back. Me, I'm here to fight back.
I just felt like this is a moment. This is like one of those great times when people finally rise up and come together, and I just wanted to be part of it.
Did you ever think that you were going to live through a protest or a march like this?
If you had asked me 5 years ago, no, but ever since I started college, yeah. And I'm kind of glad that I get to keep being a part of them.
From Brookline Interactive Group, this is Monique Avila.
Thank you to Big for that clip. Now for Jason Pramas, Network Director for BINJ, to give his closing thoughts.
The Boston Women's March for America was a tremendous success by any metric. Likely the largest political demonstration in the city's history, its estimated 175,000 attendees made it big enough to dwarf even many national demonstrations of the last many years, which shows two important things. First, there are a great many Massachusetts residents ready to fight to bring down the Trump administration. Second, the state's population is strongly in favor of women's rights, and a number of other positions mentioned in the event's mission statement, including racial justice, economic justice, human rights, climate justice, and religious freedom. So, credit where credit is due, march organizers did a wonderful job of reading the political moment and turning out the broad left against a clear and present threat to democracy, in the form of a triumphalist hard right wing of the Republican Party. However, the local march and hundreds of related actions across the U.S. last weekend, up to and including the main Washington D.C. march, all had an inherent political flaw that's going to be hard to overcome. That is, their organizers appear to have no follow-up plan beyond mobilizing voters to get the Democrats back in power. This is because the progressive nonprofits and labor unions behind the marches themselves have no high-level strategy beyond that same goal, which is why many of them could not even support Bernie Sanders, their party's credible left alternative in last year's election, and why the Dems are not much better than the Repubs on a host of key issues. And in some cases, with the Trans-Pacific Partnership that President Trump just shot down as a first order of business, they are worse. Because the organizations that comprise the progressive wing of the Democrats and provide most of its grassroots muscle continue to refuse to challenge the still dominant pro-corporate Clintonite wing of the party for control of its platform. Given that problematic background, it's easy to understand why the marches were essentially transformed into giant launch pads for the candidacies of key Democratic politicians for the 2018 and 2020 elections. In Boston, for example, the main speaker was Senator Elizabeth Warren, a clear contender for the 2020 Democratic presidential nomination, having stood down in the recent election and consolidated her power base. Other rising Democratic politicians like Mass Attorney General Mara Healey, Boston Mayor Marty Walsh, and Boston City Councilor and City Council President Michelle Wu also mounted the podium, and none could ask for a better campaign kickoff for their next races, whatever those races may be. But electing more Democrats to office is not going to solve the problems this nation is facing, especially if the party continues to be led by elitist technocrats who fake left but break right on all the issues that matter to its populist wing. An otherwise decent progressive like Warren will keep pulling her punches on effective policy prescriptions like single-payer national health care and continue to defend Obamacare when she herself has written in favor of single-payer as the, quote, most obvious solution to our health care crisis. Because she doesn't have the support of party leadership to take on corporate power. A union-backed mayor like Walsh will continue to base his economic policies on the simple conceit of attracting as many corporations to Boston as possible, as he did by supporting the GE Boston deal, in the likely vain hope that doing so will somehow result in more decent jobs for his working and middle-class constituents, instead of creating public jobs programs and building large amounts of public housing like big city Democratic poles from the 1930s to the 1960s, pushed by an ascendant and militant labor movement for much of that period. Because again, he doesn't have the support of party leadership for such policies. And because today's union and nonprofit leaders have been unwilling to push Democrats to back the democratic socialist policies that many of them privately believe in. So that's the strategic quandary that progressive Democrats of the type who just pulled off the huge and successful mass mobilizations find themselves in. They know perfectly well that a society run by and for the rich is incompatible with the fairness and justice they seek. They know that we cannot solve all the dire problems facing America by handing the reins of power to the CEOs, as both major parties have been doing for decades, and hoping for the best. And they know that the best organizing isn't top-down, but is instead horizontal and, well, democratic. Yet, even when they pull millions into a great event like the marches against President Trump, they remain afraid to let the grassroots they just inspired to action run the political movement they hope to build. And as long as that cycle continues, the Democratic Party might indeed return to power by 2020, but all the marches in the world won't bring true democracy to the United States. For Beyond Boston, I'm Jason Pramas.
On Saturday, January 21st, over 500,000 women, children, and their allies marched on Washington to reinforce the message that women's rights are human rights, gathering folks of all ages, genders, religious backgrounds, races, ethnicities, and more in a stunning display of solidarity. Sister marches in over 673 locations globally occurred alongside the D.C. March, with almost 5 million people counted as attending. The march began with a series of inspiring speakers, including Angela Davis, Michael Moore, Janet Mock, Gloria Steinem, and numerous celebrities, including Alicia Keys, Madonna, Ashley Judd, who performed a spoken word piece written by a 19-year-old girl which quickly went viral, and Janelle Monáe, who performed a rousing rendition of What You Talkin' About, featuring the mothers of the movement, mothers of unarmed black folks murdered by police, who joined in a call and response of Say Their Name. People from all over the country and world converged on D.C. for the march, many of whom represented specific causes, from reproductive rights to economic and racial justice to environmentalist concerns. A wide variety of signs featuring witty slogans such as, I've seen smarter cabinets at IKEA, and not usually a protester, but geez, were hoisted high while chants rang out in the streets. Ultimately, no matter which individual banner was waved, the march provided a powerful counter-narrative to the previous day's inauguration, suggesting a deep and foundational disagreement with the new administration's actions and a commitment to ongoing activism. In the words of one sign featuring the late Carrie Fisher, a woman's place is in the resistance, and it certainly appears that these nasty women aren't going anywhere.